feel free. These front tables, these guys are cool too. I'm sure we all want to be friends. And feel free, if you want to code along with some of this, I don't think I linked this on GitHub yet, but I'll link it as soon as I get off the stage here. I'm going to be live coding small pieces of these applications because we're pressed for time and I couldn't code the whole thing in 90 minutes. But feel free to follow along at home. Still a little early, but you guys just want to get started? Yeah? Cool. All right. So really quickly, before we get started, a little bit about myself. Welcome to jQuery First, right? First ever jQuery India conference, which is pretty sweet. I'm pretty excited to be here. I know all the other speakers are pretty stoked to be in India, possibly for the first time. My name is Alexis Abril. I work for a company called Bitovi. We basically are a small consulting firm specializing in front-end JavaScript development. So you may not have heard of us, and by may not, I mean I don't think anybody has, but you've definitely seen our work. We do a couple things. One, typically when larger corporations like Walmart or Sam's Club, T-Mobile, et cetera, have a large project they need to undertake, maybe they need to bring a team, internal team up to speed, they need some additional training, some additional tools, or they just need us to do that application for them. We're one of those small companies that fit into that niche. There's a few of us in the space, but the space is large enough, we technically don't even compete with each other, which is a really nice area to be in. But we basically just do consulting to keep the lights on, because we have to pay the bills. But what we primarily do, what we like to do, is we have a set of open source tools. Bitovi's been around for a little over 9 years, so we've been doing consulting for almost a decade, not quite yet. And these are a set of open source tools, let me scroll down a little bit, that we've built over the past decade that helps us deliver large, maintainable applications as quickly as possible. So one of the tools I'm going to talk about today is CanJS, because you can build the application you need to. It was a really kind of fun little marketing segment when we launched this a while back. But this is what we're going to be talking about today. This is an MV framework. I'm not going to say if it's MVC, MVVM, it's MV, whatever you want it to be. It's a very modular approach. I'm going to show you how we build things internally at Bitovi, and you're going to see a little bit of the API today. I don't want to go too in-depth with all the API bits, because that's basically just reading a dictionary at that point. But hopefully, it excites a little bit to go out and build fun projects of your own just to start out, maybe client or corporate projects in the future. So we're going to talk about what this is from a practical standpoint. There's a lot of fun little side projects, fun little apps out there that you can build with different frameworks, and there's a ton of different frameworks out there. But I want to emphasize a couple things when we get into this. Even before we start, don't use CanJS because I'm up here telling you to or because you think it's exciting after you see this presentation. I would say don't use anybody's framework based on what somebody else tells you. The guys in the workshop heard some similar notes yesterday as well. Educate yourself about the tools. CanJS, Angular, Ember, these are just tools for you to help build your applications. Use the right tool for the job kind of mentality. See what tools fit your team. But educate yourself about the tools. There's many times I get to a client's office and they say, we need to rewrite this application in X framework or with X tools. And that could start off like a technology debate, but I try not to debate. Instead, I'll turn to that person and just ask, why? 9 times out of 10, they are silent at that point. I have no idea why, because the museum tells us, I don't know if you're South Park fans, but it's this arbitrary reason because X superstar said it on Y blog, and that's why we're going to base our whole tech stack on this framework that we've never used before. So like I said, don't even use this because I say to, but check it out for yourself. Getting into this, this is our kind of tag moniker. It's just a very modular set of tools to help you build your applications, specifically from an architecture perspective. And when I say applications, I'm talking about the front end specifically in the browser. Oh, that is looking weird. There we go. When you hear the MV pattern, if you're familiar with MVC, MVVM, MVP, et cetera, we're basically just talking about a separation of concerns. Regardless of how you separate these out into view models, models, et cetera, you're gonna have really three large layers. And this is true, this has nothing to do with UI or server-side code. It's just where do you put your concerns when you're building your application? Typically, you'll have some kind of presentation logic. This could be in the HTML, how things are represented. It could be, if you're on the server side, how you're representing your RESTful services or your socket endpoints, what those signatures and APIs look like. You have some kind of logic layer, and this could be multiple sub-layers within your logic layer, but this is where the business decisions, the code specific to whatever your application is building resides. And typically, you have some sort of data layer. This is protecting data access or massaging data, serializing, deserializing data into specific types and formats before it gets to wherever the data is trying to go. Maybe it's trying to go to a database. If it's on the UI, maybe it's just trying to go to a RESTful request. You want to say, hey, all REST requests for this service need to be in this format. You would want that logic in some data layer. That way, any new features you build are already set up to use that same pipe. Does that make sense from a really abstract architectural standpoint? So when we're talking about this pattern, we're going to break things up into this kind of layer. The question comes up frequently, why another MV framework? And I agree completely. I have no idea why there are so many others. If you remember way back in the day, how many of you here wrote GWT? Anybody? Yeah? A couple? Yeah, those the hots at one point in time. We released JavaScript MVC, which is the parent kind of project, in late 2007. We've been around quite a while. Originally, the part, something big's going down, everyone's phone's going off. Originally, the part of project, JavaScript MVC, very old, we were able to get the name JavaScript and MVC, the two most general terms in the industry in terms of how we're building these tools. But the core project with this architecture tool set was called jQuery MX, jQuery with MVC extensions. Fast forward a little bit, around 2010, we started to realize we love using jQuery internally, but we don't need to be married to it necessarily. If you're using Dojo or YUI or MooTools or Zepto, you should be able to have the same type of architecture tool set as well. So in 2012, we released CanJS, which is just a port of jQuery MX, but without the hard jQuery dependency. Now, all the examples you will see today will be using CanJS and jQuery. We're at a jQuery conference. I wouldn't want to make it weird. But you can use it with anything. We're dropping YUI support in the next release for obvious reasons. YUI no longer exists. So this is just a little graph showing where we came from, where we're headed to. We've been around quite a while, and hopefully we're not going anywhere anytime soon. The core of what I want to talk about today is building rich applications, because this is hard. If your manager comes to you and says, hey, we need to build Gmail, that's a little bit overwhelming. I've been doing this for a little while now, and to me, that would be overwhelming. Yeah, it's a good song. Just like keep playing. It's overwhelming. There's a lot going on. If I said, can you build Gmail and give me a time frame you could build it, I would have no idea what to say. But if I said, well, can you give me some kind of widget where I type into a text box and it shows a div below it with more strings? Okay, I think I can figure that out. Well, maybe if you type into the text box, it makes an AJAX request, and the response populates that div with some strings. I think I can do that. If you click a checkbox on a row, it changes the background color of a row. Okay, I think I can do that. You want to break your application into small, reusable modules so that you can build your components to building Gmail, if that's the example you wanted to build. The secret to building large applications is don't build large applications. Small, reusable modules that you can build and piece together to build something complex. The second thing I want to stress, we're very tied to this concept of how things look in the browser. We're very concerned about that. We love making, whatever logic we're doing, we'll say, hey, $div.html, change this div's HTML on the fly, and that could be in any layer, we'll make that kind of modification. I consider that the same, if you've heard the term ad hoc database requests, I kind of consider that in the same line, to where you could technically modify anything in the database from any layer on the server side, but there's reasons you do or don't. Maintainability is one of them. So when I think about building an application, if this is our application here, if I get some design from your design department, some kind of wireframe or mockup, I think about what is the state of this application in memory? How does this look like as an object in memory? I'm gonna show you how I, kind of the thought process behind this. So here's a simple application where you pick a restaurant from some geographical location, some state and city. It'll give me a list of restaurants and I wanna order some food. But I'm gonna focus on this one screen here. Here we have a simple page with two dropdowns. It looks like the first dropdown is loading. Maybe it's making some kind of AJAX request for all the states you can order list restaurants from. And the city has a dropdown, but it looks like it's disabled. Maybe until you choose a state. That probably makes sense. So you choose, the AJAX request is completed. It says choose state. I assume that below choose state, there's a list of states that we can select from. Looks like there is. So we got some information back from some service. And if you choose a state, it's gonna make another AJAX request, it looks like, for probably a list of all the cities that these restaurants are in the state of Illinois. So, that AJAX request is completed. We get two cities, Chicago and Peoria. You select a city, and it looks like at that point, once you select a city, then it's gonna show you the restaurants available in that region. So conceptually, a fairly simple app. But how do you manage this in behind the scenes? Immediately we're thinking of how do we populate this select, how do we put the options into that input, how do we, you know, maybe we want an unordered list with some styled LIs to think about this bottom grid. That's immediately what we're, you know, we're UI developers, that's where our minds go first. I try to think of just managing an object in memory. This is why. Oh, if you change the state, I forgot one use case here. Change the state. We should probably wipe out the cities, make a new request for whatever cities are in Wisconsin now, and start the process over. I focus on maintaining state behind the scenes of the UI as opposed to modifying the interface itself for two reasons. One, it makes my applications more testable. The UI, the presentation layer in my opinion, should just be something that responds to a state change. So if I change a property on an object, if you have a person object and that person has a name property, if I change the name on that object, if it's represented in the view, something should be activated, some other tool should be changing that for me. I don't want to have to go to every div where that name was used myself and try to figure out what's going on. Does that make sense? It kind of turns into the handshake problem. If you're tight coupling logic bits to pieces in the DOM, you're going to say, hey, how many places does this piece of information get used? But let me make sure I modify all those places. If you remove one of those places, maybe it's just a silent thing. If you say $div.html, jQuery is gonna say, there's no divs with, there's nothing that matches your selector. I will quietly do nothing. Maybe it's more complex and your application throws an error. Either way, you probably don't wanna be making that modification anyways. You really only cared about changing the name of the object. Everything else is ancillary. So, looking at this application a second time, I break this down as follows. So here on the below part is kind of just what I think of in my head, how we kind of approach designing our applications from a code perspective, from an architecture perspective. If I see something like this, I'm gonna have some object in memory that says, hey, maybe we're gonna have a list of states. This is an AJAX request, so I would have some kind of promise object. We're using jQuery, maybe a jQuery deferred. Something that says, I'm gonna request data from somewhere, and I will eventually resolve to something. What it resolves to? Perhaps an array of states, a list structure of a list of states. If you select a state, perhaps you have some string. Maybe it's just a string with the actual state name that you're setting. Maybe setting this string, actually setting of the string, is what invokes the second AJAX request. Cities is another promise, because we're gonna request the list of cities for the state. So that's another promise that will resolve to this array. Maybe the city itself is just another string as well. whatever city you happen to choose. Perhaps if you've chosen the state and the city, this is what triggers the actual request for the restaurants available in that region. So in that case, restaurants will be another promise because it's an AJAX request, which will resolve to a list of restaurants. Now, if you look at just the below part, just the object, this is something we can create and test without even building a UI, without modifying any DOM. We can test the business logic way, way earlier. A lot of times we get requests, hey, I'm not seeing this div show up or the H1 doesn't have the correct value. The error has usually happened before that point. Typically, sometimes it's a typo in the view, but usually it's something logical beforehand that has gone wrong. Any musicians in the room by chance? None? Oh, one, thank you, sweet. I was gonna leave me alone out here. So I taught music for a while in my younger days. And when I was a student in music, I had a great piece of advice from a jazz instructor in college. And we were messing up the song, and we kept practicing the same area of the piece over and over and over, trying to get it right. And we always played it really well, but when we put the song together, it would always just bomb at that section. We could not figure out why. The professor came up and said, no. The place where that's just the symptom. You're observing that an error is happening here. The mistake actually happened four measures before it. That's where you got off. This is just where everybody notices it. I find that's true in a lot of life situations, programming included. By the time you're seeing the error, that's not necessarily where the bug is. That's just your observation of what's going on. The real problem has happened somewhere else. Does that make sense? So it makes debugging kind of fun in software engineering. So I basically start with this. Before I go any further, let me get here. Yeah. I'm about to build this, but we're going to build a couple things today. I don't like making slides. I prefer live coding. I like to be more interactive so you can see what we're actually doing. These are all fun words that I'm saying. Let's get to the code. As a side project, this is something we built for the local community in Dallas, but I think we're on the same subnet. If you can see my IP address there, 10.5.9.25, port 8000. Feel free to go to that address right now. If you're on the same Wi-Fi, you should be able to access it. This is a very simple CanJS application. Hopefully, if we have enough time at the end of this, maybe after the intermission, we might have enough time. We are going to live code this entire UI from scratch. But in the meantime, yeah, it's like something right here. This is a pretty small application with a couple of our approach on web components. Two components are in this application, and it's just a simple chat application that will send a message to some server that I currently have running on this machine. It will respond if you have a socket-enabled browser, which if everybody's using Chrome, you're good at this point. And we can communicate with each other. So feel free to check this out while we're going. Let me squeeze that down to where it fits on the screen. Hello. So if you enter, it's just a pretty rudimentary little chat application. Not much in terms of complexity, but I'm going to show you how we built that too. OK. So CanJS. Let's build our little restaurant application. Well, yeah. Maybe put that phone on silent. What's that? Oh, we're not on the same subnet? Oh, that's a bummer. I guess I'm on a different. Sorry, guys. That's probably because I'm hooked up to the hotel Wi-Fi, not the jQuery router. That's probably what it is. All right, no worries. I'll give you guys the code for this anyways. I'm debating which part to show you first. Let me show you the restaurant. Let's do that first. I think that makes sense. Let me fire up a local web server here. Place my order. App. All right. And most of this application is built, but I believe I deleted, yeah, I'm going to delete this part. Actually, I'm going to delete this whole file. So I have a local server running with that restaurant application. There we go. Open up my console here. And right now, this is two selects, one disabled, one that does absolutely nothing. a lot of times this is where I'll start. I'll put some static markup on the page, and then I basically add attributes to bring things to life. I'm gonna show you the attributes I added in the presentation layer, but I'm actually gonna build up the object first before we even test this kind of stuff. So, remembering before, in pseudocode, I'm basically just gonna list out what we need to do. We need some kind of construct that has the attributes that we listed a moment ago. So states, we're gonna want some kind of promise that resolves to an array of states. A singular state, which will just be some string. We're gonna have cities, which will be another promise. We're gonna make a request as soon as the state is selected, and city, which will just be the string of the city you've actually selected. Finally, restaurants, if I could spell, will be another promise, resolving to an array of the actual restaurants available in that region. So far, so good. Okay, here's a little bit of the API. I'm gonna write this in ES6, because you just had an ES6 talk before lunch, so I figured it's fitting. So, if you have questions about how I'm making this work, feel free to ask those. It's kind of off the CanJS road, but it's still in the family of products. But I'm gonna say I wanna import can's core, so I'm gonna import can from can. And I'm gonna import can map define. CanJS operates, obviously, we're very jQuery influenced in how we develop CanJS. You can treat these kind of plugins that I'm using here similar to how you would treat a jQuery plugin. You need to import it, and this plugin will modify CanJS itself somehow, giving it functionality. Same way if you import a jQuery plugin, it's gonna add a function to the jQuery prototype. Make sense? Cool. What I'm gonna do here is basically define a fancy object. So with CanJS, we're huge fans, or at Bitovi in general, we're huge fans of the observable pattern. Is everyone familiar with the observable pattern? The observable pattern? We're basically talking about how do we communicate between two modules loosely coupled. That's basically the whole purpose of this pattern. So before we can implement that pattern, we need some kind of observable entity, some object that we can listen for changes on. In CanJS, we have something called maps. So I'm gonna say var, this is just a view model for what we're doing, so I'm gonna call it VM, because I'm not original. I'm gonna say canMap.extend, export default VM. If you've seen Backbone before, you're probably familiar with the extend method. This is very similar to just saying public class VM inherits from can map, if you're from a Java background. That's basically all we're saying here. We don't have that syntax, so we type things like this. But map is just a simple object that you can listen for changes upon. That's all maps are. Cool? Sweet. What the define plugin gives us, define, is it gives us the ability to define behaviors on attributes. Things like how an attribute is get or set, getters and setters, how an attribute is serialized and deserialized. You can specify default values for attributes, and types. So if you pass in a string, type will say, hey, let's turn this into a date, perhaps, or a number if you choose, or something more complex. What I'm gonna do is set up this pseudocode in my define plugin. So what I'm gonna say is states is going to be by default, some kind of deferred entity. So my value, well, I could say value is a new can.deferred, but I really wanna make some kind of AJAX request. So this is where that data layer comes into play. I could make an AJAX request right here. This value can accept a function, so I could say $AJAX to some service will get me a list of states I wanna use in this application. With CanJS, we like to keep things really, really separated. If you're thinking in terms, I'm about to use another Java reference. How many in here is primarily like Java was your background? Show of hands. Okay, maybe I will keep using Java references. Think of it like if you have some kind of DAO, your data layer, it says, hey, all of your stored procedure requests or your SQL requests are gonna come from this layer. Your business logic really isn't going to do anything on its own. It's just going to touch modules in the data layer. CanJS gives you a data layer in the form of can model. So I have a couple models here. Let me open up state. That's an easy one. This is all the code you need to set up a request. Let me show you how this actually does. So just like we had can map extend, we're saying state inherits from can model. We're specifying a method for find all. Don't worry about what that does yet. Let me show you, like the matrix. You can't be told what it does. You have to see it for yourself. So I'm just going to blow this up. Let me make sure I didn't have any syntax errors. Yeah, I think I'm good there. Yeah, we should be good. Okay. State. Oh, didn't like that. Window. Oh. Report. State from model state. I just want this on the page. Oh, it really doesn't like that. Models. State. There we go. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to make an AJAX request just from the console here. I'm not going to worry about the UI part yet. I'm actually going to make that as big as possible. What I'm going to say is we have state.findAll. What this is going to do, oh, that's making, I have my fixtures turned on. I want that to error out, actually. States, fixtures. I'm going to show you what that is here shortly. Sweet. Okay. State, our model layer gives you a few methods out of the box. Find all, find one, create, update, and destroy. Create and update, we merge together into this save method, but we basically give you CRUD functionality out of the box. The only thing you need to do with your model layer is point it at a resource. In our case, we've specified, hey, find all is going to be on this /API/states. So if I go back to our model layer here, we're saying, hey, if you want to get a list of all the states in the database, this is where this request is going to go. State.findAll is going to make an AJAX request. This is the very same thing. Behind the scenes, we're turning this string into return $.ajax. It's going to be get URL API states. And we're actually going to serialize or deserialize the response into an instance of this model. So if you had defined behaviors on this model, the server is going to send back some object, and it will be turned into a new instance of this model. So you can listen for changes on whatever comes back from the server. So this will give us this type of functionality. Now we have a model layer to where if you want to make an AJAX request for all the states, you can say state.findAll. And you can do this all over the application. Why do I want this in a model layer? I can just type $.getstates. Isn't that easier? Maybe. It depends on how maintainable that is going to be. Because in the future, as I'm sure you know, APIs never change in an application, right? Once you have it, it is solid gold for all time. No, sometimes things change. Sometimes you have a new feature. You need to add more information. Maybe you need to change how some piece of information works in a different part of the application. If state services changed signatures, how we serialize the data, anything, I would have to go to everywhere I use $get or $ajax and make the same modifications. Here, we have it in one place, in this one little bubble, this state model, where we can cleanly access and make sure our data requests are being funneled the same way all the time throughout the application. Does that make sense? Yeah? Cool. Well, this is no good. We got a nice 404 not found. I need to call it a day. I'm going to shut my laptop. We need to wait until some server team makes this service possible. This was a very big problem early on. We don't like waiting for things. We want to build things quickly, which touches on, that reminds me of a point I want to bring up in a little bit. But we came up with a way called fixturizing, which is basically just a way to mock server requests. Mock AJAX requests, basically. Are you guys familiar with jQuery prefilters, AJAX prefilters, by chance? Anybody? I know you are. This is a really, really handy tool to manipulate or massage data. They give you a lot of hooks all wrapped around AJAX requests. If you need to make all your AJAX requests in your application, maybe they're going to be application type JSON, or maybe you want it to be some different format coming in for all the AJAX requests. Maybe you want to conditionally do something on outgoing AJAX requests. jQuery gives you a lot of hooks on how to manipulate this and how to watch this. With that functionality, we created can.fixture, which is, I'm going to uncomment this, a way to say can.fixture is just this object in memory, this registry in memory, where we say, hey, if you see an AJAX request that goes through matching this signature, get API, line 29 says get API states, if you see this coming through, it's the AJAX request is about to go out, cancel it. Don't actually make the request. Instead, just return some static data or do execute some function. At this point, now we are able to basically fake the server response, and we can build the entire application way ahead of schedule. This is developing in parallel with the server team as opposed to developing in serial. No longer do you have to wait for one team to build, finish their project. You can have this even go through iterations of your interface with whatever QA or client or user testing environment you have before the services or the database is even set up. So rapid iterations is one of the things we really, really value in terms of project success. We're using can.fixture here. You can see I'm doing all kinds of fake stuff with services we are not using yet in this coding demo. But the one we care about here is get slash API states. I uncommented that line. If I go back here and I try to make the same request, state.findAll, it's going to return this object, which, as we can see here, has a bunch of fun methods indicating we have received a deferred back. State.findAll is some AJAX request. It's some asynchronous request that has gone out into the world. And now we have some hooks to listen for when it's completed and what to do when it's completed. So I should be able to do something like this. Var deferred equals state.findAll. So we're going to get our promise back, and I'm just going to assign a pointer to it. I'm going to say dfd.then function. We should get a list of states back. I'm going to console.log states. So here, we have this array-like structure with a length of 3. If I take a peek inside one of these, we have something with a name Wisconsin and a short name of WI. Our second is something with the name of Michigan and a short name of MI. I assume the third is Illinois with a short name of IL. We have successfully received data back at the resolution of this promise. Cool? Now, we haven't touched any UI parts yet. We haven't actually manipulated the DOM. That's the whole point. We want these states to be in that select. So let's get a little bit closer to that. If we go back to our view model here, rather than say this is a new deferred, I would like, I'm going to change this slightly. I'm going to say, hey, whenever something is requesting the state's property, I would like to invoke some function. So I'm going to use a custom getter. For those of you not familiar with the syntax, you can write your function like this, but we don't have to these days. We can just say that. But it's the same thing. We're doing the same thing. Get is pointing to some function which we're about to invoke. So whenever something, like a presentation layer, says, hey, give me a list of states, it's going to trigger this get function. What this get function is going to do, states is a promise, and we just saw state.findAll returns a promise, return state.findAll. I'm going to make my model request from this layer. States will be the promise returned from state.findAll. Let us stop here and refresh the page. You can see the loading graphic went away. It says choose a state. We got our 3 back in the view. Don't worry, I'll show you the presentation here after we're done with the view model. Cool. We're starting to wire things up. Things are getting completed. Now, if I select this state, I should be able to select a city. So we need to make some other kind of AJAX request. One, I would like to define maybe some default behavior for a state itself. So our state maybe has a default value of null, or you haven't selected a state at all. However, put cities on here as well. However, if state is not null, we want to make some AJAX requests, but we're really requesting cities. So I'm going to write a cities getter. This will be a cities get function, and whenever this is called, we're going to do some logical check. We're going to say var state, this.adder state. I'm going to stop here for a moment, because this may be a little confusing. This keyword, if you were there for yesterday's workshop, follows three very simple rules. Remember, functions or methods don't exist in the traditional computer science sense in JavaScript. Functions do not know where they live in JavaScript. They only know how they are invoked. So the this keyword follows three simple rules. Dot call, which is like foo.bar. The new keyword, context will be set to the new instance of an object, and call and apply, where you're manually setting the this keyword. So with a lot of helper libraries, CanJS being one of them, we actually set the context for you to what you would actually think this is. A lot of what CanJS does is very class inspired. There's a lot of things that we thought organizationally from an architecture level are make maintainable code. So this, in this getter, will refer to the instance of this view model. So it's going to have its own state's promise, its own city's promise, its own state value. But it's going to be unique to the instance of this view model, of this object. So all I'm doing is saying, hey, give me our current state's attribute. We do this by saying dot adder. If you're familiar with jQuery's adder method, it's very similar, except we're not talking about getting the attributes of a DOM element. We're getting the attributes of an object. Why not just say this.state? It's how we listen for events and how we set events in CanJS. Nothing wrong or right. Angular will let you do this.state. It'll let you play with the general objects. But this is just a different approach. When you're listening for events or binding to events in Angular, there's actually a polling mechanism behind the scenes that will see when the object is changed. If you're curious about this feature, it's called dirty checking. CanJS, we spend a little bit of extra time setting up these objects and wire up our own events. So that when you call this.adder, we don't have a polling mechanism that says, are you changed, are you different? We know immediately, you called this.adder, something is changing right now. Does that make sense? Nothing wrong or right about either, really. It's just a different approach. So what I'm saying is check the current state. If the current state exists, we want to make some AJAX request. Now I'm going to use a little different syntax. I'm going to say return if state exists. I want to say city.findAll with state. Otherwise, don't return anything at all. City is another model, which I need to import up here. Import city from models city. City is another abstraction. It's just going to access a city resource on some database or some server. And we're going to try to make an AJAX request, but only if the state exists. If the state exists, then we will try to make the city request. Let's see if we wired this up correctly. Oops, I got a typo. Where is it? Oh, wait. Line 25? State. That looks good. I'm pretty sure it's right there. Nope, it's before there. Oh, there. Thank you. Good eye. Okay. So now if I choose a state, it's going to set the state property. It should make an AJAX request, which it just did. Let me see if I can slow this down. And fixture.delay, 2000. I'm going to make a request. It's making an AJAX request, going out to the server. 2 seconds had passed. We're simulating a slow latency. Server response is slowed down, but the city has resolved. The promise resolved here. And now we have a list of cities in the second select box. kind of a fun little note, fixtures are really good for, again, simulating AJAX requests or preventing AJAX requests from going out. But we don't just mock data. We let you mock everything on the request. So if you wanted to set up a, in this case, I'm just simulating a slow latency connection. I said, hey, increase the delay to 2,000 milliseconds. We have a default to delay of 200 milliseconds just to give you enough to feel like something's happening. So you can have whole sets of fixtures, which I typically do in a large application. Whole sets of fixtures that say, this is how the application will respond with a bunch of 500 errors. This is how the application will respond if you're unauthorized. This is how the application will respond in a really slow latency session or area. And here's how the application will respond in ideal settings. I prefer to have many sets of fixtures because I want to know how the application will look if the server gets struck by lightning before the server actually gets struck by lightning. How many of you in the room use Gmail today? A few people? You're all aware that Gmail is a thing. Everyone in the room has seen it, right? Have you guys seen Gmail crash? Gmail throw an error? Yeah? Some say no. What does it look like when it does? Oops. Nice little pink, reddish warning at the top that says, oops, something's going wrong, but you feel nice and taken care of, like, oh, they're holding me. I feel good right now, even though something really serious could have just happened. And they test this. It wasn't like by coincidence, like, oh, you know, it's, you don't want to receive like the 500 Apache server unavailable error. You want to have something that tests whether or not your UI can respond to those kinds of requests. So you can set that up with fixtures. Simulate slow connections, aired connections, to make sure you're in the right mindset. So let me get rid of this delay, because we don't need that. So that was for a dramatic effect. So far, we have our states set up. We're making states request. We got our promise back. We have our cities set up. Now we can say, hey, let's make sure we set our city. Let's have a default value here of null as well. But what I would like to do, one of the additional parameters of this page in the application is if you reset the state, if you set the state a second time, it should wipe out the cities. So whatever city you have selected, maybe you should reset it. So what we could do here is say, actually I'm gonna leave that for a second. Let me put restaurants in here too. Restaurants. Restaurants was our final promise. So, what I'm gonna do here, let's see, if you set the state, I'm gonna put a set function. With setters in CanJS, you're gonna get the new value coming in that you would like to set, and whatever you do in that function, whatever you return, is gonna be the actual value that's set on that property. So setters are basically this hook before the actual setting happens, if that makes sense. So maybe somebody sets, if you have a pagination view model and somebody wants to set the page to -1, you say, hey, if this is less than 0, don't use that, use 0 instead. And you don't let them set the value to -1, you just reset it to 0. So you have a lot of power over how attributes, how properties of an object are manipulated. In this case, if the state is reset, I'm gonna say this.adder city is null. Just gonna reset the city selection back to null. So if I'm in Illinois and I change it to Chicago, I go back to Wisconsin, change the state to Wisconsin, Chicago should not be selected anymore. It's gonna go back to choose a city. Make sense? The final piece of this is, in restaurants, what I would like to do is say, on my getter, whenever you try to retrieve restaurants, I'm gonna check to see, do I have a city and do I have a state? Then try to find all the restaurants in that region. So we can do the same thing we did for getting the cities. I'm gonna say var state is this.adder state. City is this.adder city. Then I'm gonna return if city and state both exist, then I'm gonna say restaurant.findAll. We have another model another AJAX request. We have something called /API/restaurants. And I want to make a service request out to that with the parameters of state, and city. If city and state don't exist, I'm just going to return null. So far, so good? Yeah? So now if I refresh, we should be able to see Green Bay here. Oh, don't forget to import what you're using. Restaurant from models, restaurante. Wisconsin, Green Bay, we made a request out and we got a list of restaurants back from the server. If I did this correctly, Illinois, it's going to wipe out the city, which will in turn wipe out the restaurants because restaurants getter is saying if city and state. So as a response, it's going to wipe out both, choose Chicago, and we got a new set of restaurants. It's the fake set, so it's the same set of restaurants. This isn't an actual server request. Or Spago is just a really popular restaurant. But we have now a responsive way to control what is happening in the UI. Now, intentionally, you may have noticed at this point, we are not doing anything in the DOM in this layer. The DOM is responding to the changes we're making in this layer, but I'm not saying dollar, you know, find some selector and change the contents of that element. I'm not even technically making AJAX requests directly from this layer as well. This is a very abstract kind of thing where I can say, let me just do this too. window.vm equals vm. Expose this out here. rvm equals new vm. If I wanted to test and make sure that the logic behind my application is doing what I expect it to be doing, I can write this code here. Not in the console. Preferably you'd have this in some kind of test, but I'm doing it in the console. So I can say var vm equals new vm. Blow that up. And we should have a default set of attributes. I'm going to serialize our fancy object. You can see we have the default values of city and state being null. If I try to do something like vm.adder, I'm going to try to get states. You can see a request went out for states. I'm going to say vm.serialize one more time. Oh, we don't have a state selected. So if I say vm.adder states, it's just going to make the AJAX request. What I would like to do is say vm.adder. What I'm going to do, I'm going to clear this noisy part out, is I'm going to set the state to Illinois. And the act of setting the state should trigger our city's AJAX request. Hey, we need to make an AJAX request. A state just got selected. And we should have now adder cities getting a response back. There's our promise. We can completely go through the business logic of this particular page, this particular application, without worrying about how things are going on in the DOM. I'm not saying you shouldn't test the DOM. I'm saying there's two concerns you have here. Your primary concern is setting the state to IL, and then you have a secondary concern as well to making sure those states appear in some select box. Does that make sense? With separating out these concerns, building something like Gmail becomes somewhat more trivial. Because if I said, hey, give me a list of all the recent emails for a particular user, I don't know where to start. But if I said, make an AJAX request for this service, I think I can figure out how to do that. Does that make sense? The secret to building large applications is don't build large applications. Any questions so far? I showed you a bunch of new APIs that you've probably never seen before. Cool? All right. So, going on with this mindset, you can build some really, really powerful stuff. For your entertainment and enjoyment, Place My Order is a live demo app, placemyorder.com, and it's full entirety and is available on GitHub. I believe under CanJS. If you go to GitHub CanJS, it'll be out there. little slow. I should have downloaded this one. But you can actually see, we wanted to provide a demo. This was something our designers actually came up with. It was actually a lot of fun because it looks like a real ordering site. So we might want to put a little label here that says, no, you won't actually order food from these restaurants. But you can click around. We have a lot of different components that we use in CanJS in this application for that reason. We wanted to say, hey, to do MVC is kind of cool, but that's not really how we build large applications. That's a very specific set. So this is something we have things like routing, state maintenance, how different components and widgets communicate with each other. Routing saying if I click on some tab, it's going to go to some URL. I can go backwards and forwards, which I'm not going to do because the latency is a little slow. But all this is open source and free for you to check out. I'm going to break this down a little bit simpler. This is a little bit more complex in terms of how we do view models. Typically, when I'm building applications today, I follow the MVVM pattern, which is the model view view model. Model being our data layer, view being our presentation layer, view model being this kind of business logic thing. And you can have many VMs. It's not like one VM is tied to anything necessarily. Just a way, a place to put some kind of abstract logic container. So when we're building stuff like this, that's what we're talking about. But we can take a step back and build something a little bit more. So I'm going to start from a blank slate with this grid folder. Let me see which process this is. Oops. Yeah, we can leave that there. Cool. Well, do I want to talk about the APIs? Yeah, maybe I'm going to talk about the APIs before I get into a simple grid demo. So you saw a lot of stuff. You saw can maps, this observable object interface. You saw this define plugin where we define how properties are set or how their behaviors work on a given object. The reason all this exists, the reason all these tools and different APIs exist, again, is constructing. These are small, individual little modules that we use to build up to really complex components and applications. It all starts with something called can.construct. So how many people in here are experts on prototype-based inheritance? Really common. Maybe you've seen proto and you're like, what is that property actually doing? Maybe you've seen a little bit of it, but you don't really know how to explain it to another person. So your comfort levels will kind of vary. But most people in the room, I would wager, are very familiar with classical inheritance. Is that something I would, is everyone's nodding their heads yes? Okay, cool. So JavaScript, there's no classical inheritance model. There's no way to say public class person inherits, like colon inherits from human, that kind of context. But there's a few things that classes in the traditional, like C-sharp and Java sense, bring to the table that are kind of nice for very large applications. So we came up with CanConstruct. This was originally called $class, which was inspired by a very old article from John Resig, the simple class inheritance, simple class-based inheritance, if you're interested in older blog articles. But CanConstruct is a way to set up simple inheritance in JavaScript. Most frameworks at this point have something similar, but it basically lets you do this. So you can say var or human equals can.construct.extend. You can say var person equals human.extend. CanConstruct is our basic level of setting up inheritance. It's where we get this extend ability from, var p equals new person, and we should see p instance of person, p instance of human. That should both be true. So behind the scenes, we're setting up the necessary properties for you to have this inheritance architecture in JavaScript with a very simple API, this extend API. Along with CanConstruct, you get the ability to set defaults and methods on given prototypes so that maybe humans can eat and p people can have a profession. You can get specific at different layers, any way you would want to set up this kind of inheritance structure. But can construct is kind of the basis. It's like ground zero for everything that we're doing in CanJS. Can maps take can constructs a little bit to the next level? Can map inherits from can construct? Because we want this simple JavaScript inheritance, but we want to be able to observe when properties and attributes change. This is where we get can maps from. Originally, we called can map can observe. I think a lot of frameworks still call it something observe. We changed it to maps because down the pipe, you're going to have observable objects in your browsers natively, which will be pretty sweet. Hence the name change. Models take maps a step further. Models are maps, which you can listen for changes from, just like maps. But models give you this RESTful abstraction interface. So you can make an easy way to say, hey, all my requests for the people service will go through this model. Make sense? This is all at the kind of the data layer level. One of the things I think about when I'm building rich applications, if you have a very rich data layer, a very rich model layer, building the presentation is easy. That's the fun part. How do you add a grid? I can't tell you how many times I get the question, how do you add a, we have a really complex grid in our application. Who here has a really big grid in their application? Yeah, pretty much, I would say, I feel like some of the hands maybe are not going up. Everybody, what application doesn't have a giant grid or list of something? Just anything, it's a list of stuff. There's a lot of really good jQuery plugins out there that let you make grids dynamically with some simple data sets. jQuery Grid is one of them, it's really, really popular. And we get a lot of questions on, how do I add a column dynamically to jQuery Grid? And immediately I'm thinking, maybe you should be using something custom. A lot of times we try to shoehorn our data or whatever we're trying to do into some generic module or response. Educate yourself about what that module is doing, and if you can't use it anymore, don't be afraid to make your own. We're all engineers, that's what we do. So, when I'm talking about building the presentation layer, if we have a rich view model where we can say, hey, once states is set, the city's properties is gonna populate itself. We don't have to worry about doing that. The model is set up already. We just have to use it. Then how do you add this data to the DOM? You write a table in your DOM. How do you add a column to it? Then you add a table cell to the table. The presentation becomes very, very trivial if you have this rich data layer. So this is all coming from where we're about to head. We have a couple things to help you set up this view layer before I get into that. I'm gonna show you what this view layer looks like specifically. You've heard about different view rendering engines. CanJS has a couple, but we really focus on one, which is can.stash. It's a mustache-inspired syntax, so if you're familiar with mustache or handlebars, this will look very, very familiar. And we wrap this up with something called can.component. Are you guys familiar with web components? Yeah, some people are. Have you heard the term web components at least? Okay. A web component is just a custom HTML tag. You can define your own behaviors, but it's something that you've built and you want to share in a declarative syntax with some other module or some other department, however you want to share these modules. We're not there yet. This component concept is defined with just JavaScript and CSS, but this isn't something we can just share with other teams or other companies quite yet. So we have a lot of frameworks that give you some kind of intermediary solution, CanJS being one of them. At this point, I believe most of the major frameworks all have some kind of solution to let you have custom HTML tags. Angular has its own syntax. CanJS is going to have a similar kind of approach. Ember, not similar to Angular, I don't know why I said that. Ember is going to have its own syntax. React has the JSX templating setup. Everybody has their own way to give you the ability to have custom elements in the DOM somehow. So, with CanJS, we give you can components, which you can define. Let me blow this up. I'm gonna show you that restaurants one, restaurant list, in this fashion. This is the code you saw a second ago. All we're saying is register this tag, PMO-restaurant-list, so that somewhere in the DOM you could say, open caret PMO hyphen restaurant hyphen list close caret. The same way you would just say open caret div close caret. You can use this as an HTML tag in the DOM. We're going to specify the HTML and the JavaScript behavior for this tag. The JavaScript being the business logic layer, that is in the view model that we just wrote. What this is saying is every time you use this tag, this will create a new instance of our view model map, our view model object. So every component will have its own basically state, if that makes sense. The template is just the markup, but it's not in pure HTML, it's in mustache syntax with the CanStash engine. So you can do stuff like this. I'm going to skip down here to the select for states, and we're going to say if states.isPending. States, remember, is a promise. So it has a bunch of cool, you know, hooks like then do this, fail, do this other thing, but it also gives you status updates. You can say, is this promise in a pending state? Is it in a failed state? What state is this promise in? And we can declaratively state, if the states are pending, maybe show the word loading. This is what you saw in the cities select dropdown where I just increased the latency to like 2 seconds for the response. You saw a little loading icon or a little loading text. So if you wanted to add a loading graphic to your page, if this promise is pending, show this image. Else, do this other thing, show other data. So this becomes really, really easy to set up in a declarative approach. If a state currently is not selected, this is, if you're familiar with regular expressions, the hat is just the negation of whatever is after it. So I'm saying not if. If state doesn't exist, then show an option that says choose the state. That's all I'm stating here. If the state does exist, then don't show this option at all. Here, let me get this more on the screen. There we go. If the state does exist, we want to go through each one of these states. I'm saying states.value. Value is our little hook to whatever the promise has resolved to. We can't say each states because that's the promise itself. Value is the resolution of the promise. I want to iterate through each one item in that array and just render the short name as the option value. So it'll say option value equals IL, but the actual the value or the text rendered in the DOM will be Illinois because I want the full name. Does that make sense? And you can do this all through your markup. So because we built that view model first in a very rich context, putting this together is just basically just dropping whatever elements and styles you want on the page. Make sense? Cool? All right. Yeah, you do have a sense of logic because you have if. Mustache at its core is supposed to be logicless templates, but if is also in the mustache spec, so that's kind of like counterintuitive. So you do have some sense of logic, but this isn't necessarily your business logic. This is what I consider presentation logic. Does that make sense? So when I say logic layer, I'm talking about the business logic layer, rules that are specific to the business. Presentation logic is really what do I see on the page? It's not necessarily what property is set and is it set correctly. If that makes sense. Very good observation. There is a sense of presentation logic happening here. But this is decoupled. The presentation layer doesn't really care about anything going on in the business logic internally, and vice versa. The business logic itself is just setting attributes on objects. It doesn't say, hey, make sure you change the div's HTML, or make sure that this new background is green. It's just setting properties, and this view is responding to them. Does that make sense? Cool. Putting things together in this fashion lets us build up really, really rich applications very, very quickly. So let's start from scratch. How are we doing on time? I'm going to assume that we're OK. Wait, what time is the tea break? You missed it? Oh, I can just keep talking. Let's take 10 minutes. We've been going for, I guess, an hour at this point. Let's take a quick 10-minute break, get up, stretch your legs, get some water, get some coffee. I know there's got to be still coffee out there. We'll come back, and I'm going to live code this from scratch, and hopefully we'll get to the chat application, and we'll just do it from scratch as well. And I will stick around for questions. You can find me around roaming the halls and whatnot. Cool? Let's come back at 2:40. Thanks, guys. Really simple grid. I don't even think this one's going to need too much view model logic. Maybe we can add some to it, depending on how we see fit. But I want to show you this from the ground up at a simpler level. So with using steel is kind of really ingrained with all we're doing. Steel is just our loader. It's how we can say one file depends on another file within this project. JavaScript doesn't have this functionality yet, but in the meantime, we can polyfill it with something like steel. And this, you can use this with it. You can use require, you can use your own different loaders, browserify. I'm using steel because I want to write an ES6 for this demo, because that's a cool thing. So this is what I'm saying here. Steel is going to look inside. It says, oh, you're using NPM. Rather than have another manifest file, like a steel config or a require config, we already have this manifest file in the project called package.json. So I'm going to look in that for where we want to start. I have a main tag that shows, or a main attribute that says, hey, the application starting point is here at index. So I'm going to add an index.js. This will be the first place that the application comes to when the project kicks off. And I'm just going to say console.log, hello. And we should here see hello in the console. So this is kind of nice. At a very simple level, we know that the application is at least doing what we expect. We want to do something a little bit more complex than hello. Maybe we want to modify the DOM somehow, so I want to use jQuery for this. Import $ from jQuery. And I'm going to say $body.html, hello. I'm just going to modify the body of the entire, or the HTML of the entire body to hello. There we have hello on the top left of the page. So far, so good. So we know with jQuery we can modify the DOM elements contents, modify DOM elements in general. I would like this to take this even further. I would like to have some method that can create DOM elements from some type of template. So in our case, I'm going to use the stash engine. I'm going to use it directly. So I'm going to say import can from can. And I'm going to import our can view stash plugin. And what I'm going to say is var template is equal to can.stash, hello. What this is going to do is it's going to parse that string and return a function. So template right now is a function. And whenever you invoke this function, template open close parens, it's going to create a document fragment. This is a lightweight version of a DOM element that we can manipulate very quickly. But in our case, I just want to insert that fragment directly into the DOM. So I'm taking our hello string, creating a document fragment out of it, and inserting it into the DOM of the page. So we should, at the end of the day, see, you know what, I'm going to change this just so it says, so we know it's something different. We should see hello world in the page. So far, so good. Why did we go through all that trouble? Why not just say dollar body hello world? Well, because this can do some cool stuff, like have mustache tags. So I'm going to say hello name. Now all we need to do in this function can accept an argument, this will be the data that we merge with that template. Does that make sense? So we're going to merge some object with this string. If you're familiar with JSPs, ERBs, ASPs, JSXs, they're all string parsers. That's all we're doing. They're very fancy string parsers, but that's all they're doing is saying, hey, here's a giant string with some special tags, and we're going to replace those special tags with other values. At its core, every view engine is doing that much stuff. Does that make sense? Okay, so all we're saying is, in our special tags, they're double curlies or single curlies or triple curlies, but they're mustaches. And I'm gonna merge in name is Alexis, or name is jQuery India. And now, if I refresh this, it should say, hello, jQuery India. It took our object and merged it with a string. Now, with this concept alone, where did that object come from? Now you can start making requests. You can say, make an AJAX request, get some object, and then parse that with the string. Maybe the string comes from somewhere else. With these, this simple rule, you can break this out into a much more complex picture. This is going to be terribly unmaintainable. I don't like maintaining markup in a string. I would prefer this if it was in its own file. With steel and can, you can do that really easily. I'm going to create an index.stash. The extension is kind of arbitrary unless you're using some kind of plugin syntax. Steel, as a result, system.js has its own plugin syntax. Very similar if you're used to using require plugins. In require.js, you can do stuff like this. Define like text, bang, foo. And it's going to say, hey, retrieve this foo resource and run it through the text plugin. In system.js or in steel, you're going to say something like import and then index.stash, bang. It's going to say run it through the extensions plugin. So stash is something special. The bang says, this isn't a JS file. Do something else with it. Run it through this thing. So all I'm going to do, this is our template file. I'm going to say, hello, name is awesome, just so we know it's a different file. And I'm gonna put it in an H1. Just so we can get a semblance that this is a markup file. And over here, rather than do this whole thing, I'm gonna say import template from index.stash bang. So the bang denotes that stash is a special plugin. The dot slash, if you're familiar with Unix file searching conventions, this is just saying, look for this file in my current directory. Dot is my current directory, slash, index.stash. And once I get this whole thing, this will return it. The stash plugin will return a function back. So now, we should be able to see, hello, jQuery is awesome in an H1. Everyone still good so far? Still with me? All right. So let's make this more complex. What I like to do typically if I have a wireframe and I'm working on the interface that I just got from the designer first is I'll set up this in a static markup context. Don't worry about making things dynamic yet. Don't try to do too many things at once. I just put the markup on the page and make sure it looks the way I expect it to. I'm gonna say table. This is just for Bootstrap. I'm using Bootstrap because I'm not a designer and I did something that looked kind of pretty right off the bat. Because if I designed things, and I'm just going to give it some basic grid properties. I'm going to think of a simple grid. Maybe we're going to show a list of users, and we'll show their name. And how about their favorite color? Oops. TH favorite color. I'm going to show two columns with their favorite color. What I would like to do is show one column with their favorite color as the value of an input, and then one column with the entire column, like the background, will be that color. So, I'll say tr, td, name will be Alexis, td, favorite color will be an input with the value of blue. TD. And I'm gonna set the background color to blue as well. Now if I refresh this page, we're gonna have a really simple grid set up that just shows a name, an input, and a favorite color. At a static sense, we're like, okay, this is starting to look like the application I wanted to build. Let's give this more power. I would really like this to show a list of users. That's the primary goal here. So how do we get a list of users on this page? Let's take a step back, because we wanna say, okay, we're not worried about LIs anymore. We're worried about making an AJAX request. So I'm going to create a models folder. I'm going to create a new model to represent what we're trying to do. I'm going to call this user.js. It's only by convention, but I typically name my models in singular. The same way you would name a class if you had a person class in Java, you would say public class person, not public class people, the pluralization of it. Because typically you'll have some kind of generic collection called, you know, open caret list, close caret people or person, that'll make your list of people. For this, all we need is can from can. And I'm gonna say var user with a capital U, k can.model.extend. Again, by convention, I typically name variables that you can create instances of with a capital letter. If it's with a lowercase letter, then I don't expect you to use the new keyword. All of CanJS is built in this fashion, so you'll see some things with lowercase, some things with uppercase. That denotes what you can create instances of. That's all we're saying. Export default user. We also give you a shortcut, resource users. Earlier you saw find all, so we have five methods, find all, find one. Find all is all the users, find one is find a singular user. Create will create, it'll make a post request to the server. Update will make a put request to the server. Destroy will make a delete request to the server. When you're designing your APIs, please use your HTT verbs. Always, 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 it's a great way to categorize things. I can tell you for the bulk of my career in .NET development, I did not. Everything was a GET request, and it was terrible. I thought it was cool, but it was not. It was not a good idea. And then I discovered, oh, there's objects that are too big to go in the URL. Oh, there's POST requests. Everything was a POST request after that. Still not a good idea. If I'm a developer and I'm coming to your team, and I'm looking at your code, it doesn't matter how talented or intellectual that person may be, I'm not going to understand your code on day one. Probably not on day two either. The first thing I'm going to look at is your API. And if everything's a GET request, now I don't understand that either. There's not a single thing I'm going to understand. So at least let me know what the verbs are doing. It's like, oh, there's a delete request. Oh, that probably destroys something. Here's a GET request. That looks like it's going to retrieve something. So if you are following standard REST conventions, this will give you the following requests. It'll give you find all, which is get slash users, find one, get slash users with a given ID, creating user, post users, updating user, users with an ID, and deleting users with a given ID. If you use resource, we'll just give you all of those out of the box. Hey, this is using standard REST conventions. I don't want to type that much. My endpoint is the user's API. So that's what I'm going to do here. Again, this is not doing anything with the DOM, so we can test this immediately. Render user, excuse me, equals user. I make sure it's available. Import user from models user. So if I refresh this grid, go down here, I can say user.findAll, and we should see a breaking AJAX request. It's going to make a 404, because it's actually trying to retrieve data. That was a real request that went out. We know our model is working. If I said var user equals new user, user.adder name, I'm setting the name of the user to Alexis. I'm going to say user.save. This save will create a, it will execute a create or update request depending on if there's an ID that exists on this object. If an ID exists, we assume that it's something that exists on some server resource and we'll create a put request. In this case, the ID does not exist, so if I hit save, we're going to get a post request. If I go to the network and I click the post request, I look in the body, we sent the object data, name colon Alexis. So we've successfully made a post request to the server. Now it's erroring out because the server doesn't exist. I don't want to write a server, so we can get around that by using fixtures. So, let me clear that out. Before we go any further, let's create some fake data, fixtures, new file, and I'm gonna call this users.js. And I'm gonna say import can core from can. And a plugin, can util fixtures. Fixture. Is it fixture or fixtures? I think it's singular. Yeah. What I'm gonna do first, before I wire up which request should go to which data, I'm gonna generate some fake data. We give you a helper function called store. So I'm gonna say var store equals can fixture.store. Store takes two arguments. One is a number. How many fake things do you want to create? The second is a callback function. What do you want to do to create your object? I want to create 10 users. Function, well, we said ES6 syntax. So, there we go. This is the same. If you're not familiar with that, it's not exactly the same function I. But it's similar to this. The only thing that's different between the rocket syntax and this, and for purposes of this example, is context. You have a lexical scope versus this is going to give us a new, it's going to change this for us. This will not. I'm not using this in this anyways. But what we're going to do, this callback function will be executed 10 times. I'm going to create these 10 objects that are returned. So in my case, I'm going to simulate what a server would return for individual users. Maybe that has an ID of I, so it's going to return objects of ID 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And maybe a name of user 0, user 1, user 2. And maybe a favorite color, but I'm just going to hard code that to blue, not blur. Export default store, just in case somebody wants to use this module. Now this is just creating the fake data. What we want to do is wire this up to jQuery's pre-filters and say, hey, before an AJAX request goes out, check it to see if it matches one of our signatures. We can do that with can.fixture directly. I'm going to say can.fixture. For the get user's signature, if you're finding all the users you want, then don't make the request, call store.findAll instead. The store, canFixture store is going to return this kind of data store object with the same API that models have. So if you're using a findAll method in the model, you have a findAll method in fixtures. Just to clarify, because this happens a lot, fixtures are basically just your test code. You can use it for running tests so you don't hit some server while you're automating your tests. You can run it while services don't exist so you can test building the API, but this is not production code. Fixtures should not make it out the door. It's only for you, the developer, to run your application without a service. Does that make sense? Every now and then I see these fixtures like sneak its way into production code. I'm like, no, that's just, you're making it heavier for no reason, because there's no benefit for having these. So with this setup, I'm going to include our fixtures here. Import fixtures, users. And now, if I said user.findAll, we're gonna get back our promise. We didn't get an error. You can see the little info message. Using a dynamic fixture for get users, that means our fixture pre-filter found the same signature and said, we're not really going to go out into the world. Here's a fake data set. If I were to open this up and say user.findAll, then function users console.log users, curly brace, that's all of them, I think. There is our map, there's our array. You can see we have 10 observable entities in there, each one with a favorite color blue, ID of 0, user 0. If I go down to number 7, blue, ID 7, user 7. We have 10 individual entities that our fixtures are simulating being returned from some service. Cool? Now, what we can do is, now that we can make that request, what I would like to do is pass it into our template. So what I'm going to do is here, I'm going to say users is going to be user.findAll. I'm going to make users the promise that we're going to return. Now this promise will be available in our template. So if I go to our template here, I should be able to see users. I'm going to log. Just a console log from the template level saying, hey, what is my current scope? What do I currently have access to? And we should see an object come here. Here's users, and if I expand it, it is our promise. So this is good. This is a handle to some AJAX request that has gone out into the world. So we can do things like, when this promise is resolved, each users.value, because we want the resolved version, and that's all I'm going to change. It's still a hard-coded table row, but it should create 10 of them, one for every resolved item in the array. If I clear this out, refresh the page, Now we have 10 rows. So we know we're correctly rendering the response that we just got back from the server. This is good. Maybe the server's taking a long time. We want to show a loading graphic. So maybe that's a different table row. Table row here, td, call span equals 3, loading. But we only want to show this if users is pending. Here we can say if users is resolved. Oops, resolved. If. If I refresh this now, it's going to say loading for a split second and then load the grid. I can slow that fixture down as you saw before. I'm going to just say can.fixture.delay equals 2000 milliseconds. That should give us a loading graphic for as long as we need. Then it's going to remove, the templating engine is going to remove that element from the DOM and insert our new table rows in that segment. Cool. We don't probably want to just hard code some list of names and values. Rather, it'd be nice if this was tied to some value. So we have a cross-binding syntax. Every framework has its own kind of cross-bound syntax. Ours is just can value. And I'm going to say this is crossbound to favorite color. I'm going to use the same here, but I'm not going to crossbind it. I'm just going to listen for changes because this isn't an input. Favorite color. And instead of the name, I want to actually render the user's name itself. So by changing those properties to a more dynamic syntax, again, if you're familiar with mustache or handlebars, this should look very familiar. I can refresh this now, and we have users 0 through 9, all 10 users. But if I change this color, it's going to live update anywhere else that attribute is being used. Again, we're only focused on changing the properties of an object. The view is just responding to those changes. Nowhere in my code did I say, on change here, dollar find the sibling table cell and change its background color. I shouldn't have to worry about that. You want a tool set that kind of handles that for you. Does that make sense? Is there any questions on what I've shown you so far? I kind of want to stop for a second because I'm realizing we're approaching the end of this session very quickly. Yeah, go for it. When the promise is resolved. Mm-hmm. Yes. No, only the promise section. So this, that's a very good question. No, this entire markup is already processed. What the view engines, what most view engines are typically doing is parsing this string and turning it into a function. But we're going to create whatever necessary document fragments we need to and put them in the DOM as quickly as possible. Inside this if users is resolved, this is going to be its own function. This whole thing will turn into a document fragment. We will put that on the page. When this promise is resolved, we have an event listener saying, oh, something is finished. We're going to create this document fragment and insert it into wherever it's supposed to go. Does that make sense? But that's a good question. We're not going to wait for this whole thing, you know, what if this is a really slow AJAX request? And this is how you have things like Gmail. If you've used Gmail on a slow connection, you see pieces of the page start to load. That's what's basically going to happen. If this was a really slow connection, you can see, let me put the fixtures back to a really slow latency. Loading, name, favorite color, the heading of the table, you have DOM on the page. We're not going to stop rendering just because something is taking a long time. It's only that segment, in our case the TRs, that will take whatever time it needs to. And you can show a nice little loading or oops, whatever you choose to show to kind of baby the user while you're making your updates. What's going on behind the scenes? More than I can explain in the next five or 4.5 minutes. But if you're interested in all of this stuff, we have a weekly podcast, and we're about to get into the CanJS section. So check us out on Bitovi's YouTube channel. During the podcast, it's live and open to the public, so you can actually chat with the core team directly. And we'd be happy. Justin, who typically runs the podcast primarily, I'm usually his co-host, would have more than enough enjoyment detailing all the intricacies to all the engines. But we also have I'll put in some links in the jQuery talk area, the conference engine area for this talk. I'll put some links to the slides we have detailing how the view engine works, how components are set up. We have much more in greater detail talks than I could squeeze into a 90-minute show here. It's hard to explain, like, how do you build Gmail in 90 minutes? It's kind of that was basically what we're tackling here, so go for it. Yes. No, I only have it in one file. I put it in the index file. Typically, in a major application, I don't even put it there. I configure it dynamically somewhere else so that no production code has it at all. I'm doing it just in the index file because this is a really simple, this grid didn't even have a component. It's just a very, very basic example of CanJS. But you're right, typically I don't have fixtures even in that file. If you're using System.js, there's a config dependencies option where you can check dynamically what mode am I in, is there some, however you want to differentiate production versus a development test environment. If it's in a test environment, load fixtures. If not, don't worry about it. Yes, you can have your own logic with fixtures. I didn't touch that, but I left the door open right here, export default store. So if something was importing from this fixture set, they could modify the store if they needed to. So you could have really, really rich fixture setups if you wanted to, totally. Good questions. Yeah, yeah, sorry, you're right behind the light there. What's up? Sure. You don't think about where it's stored. It could be stored on IndexedDB, Mongo, or a piece of paper, or a hamster running on a wheel. However you store your data is behind a screen that we should not even know about. All we're going to know about is some API endpoint that we're going to touch. Oh, okay, I see what you're saying. Yeah, well, in that case, you can remodel model. You can set up model to have your own custom access methods. I see what you're saying now. So find all, find one, create, update, all those are right now just assuming that you're making a simple REST request. If you wanted to make a custom request, you can make find all a function, and that function could do anything you want it to do. And it'll still be in one place, and when you create nuances of the model, you could say find all. That find all could be looking local storage first or on a server primarily. That logic is up to you. One of the biggest differences between us and the other frameworks is we try to make this as modular as possible. You'll notice in all of these files, I'm like, import can from can, import this plugin, import this. If you don't like all of CanJS, that's okay. If you just want to use fixtures and you want to use it with Angular, I think we have a demo of doing exactly that, I think. If you want to use just components or just models, obviously, I have a personal preference to use it all together because they mix well together, but you can use each little piece as it may be. When we were with JavaScript MVC, not when we were with them, we built it, but when we were primarily using JavaScript MVC, we had the it's our way or the highway kind of attitude, and then in 2009, we started like, hey, it'd be cool to just break this out. Maybe it's better for the community, maybe it's just better for us, we can maintain things easier. So we broke it out into many different modules. So now it's a very open kind of system. There's a lot of people that use CanJS with Browserify. There's people who use the CanJS with different view engines entirely. If you wanted to use CanJS with Twitter's Hogan, which is mustache compliant, that's cool. You can totally do that. Live binding won't work the way you expect it, or you'd have to wire things up manually because we handle that for you in the stash engine. But as long as you're comfortable with that, you could basically do whatever you would like to do. Out of time. We have a 15-minute break between talks, but that is the end of the time here. I'd be happy to stay up here. I will slowly close my laptop for the next 15 minutes to get off stage for the next presenter. But if you have questions, feel free to follow me around the halls. And thank you for coming to jQuery Bangalore. That's all I got.